asking when we're going to start Romans chapter 12. Obviously, she's anxious. So what we're going to do today is I want to say just look at a few things regarding the issue of the deliverer. Next Sunday morning, we'll finish chapter 11. Paul gives this glorious doxology at the end of chapter 11, the end of that third section of the book of Romans. And then the following week, we will begin Romans chapter 12, which of course is the start of the fourth and final section in the book of Romans. Now, when we start Romans chapter 12, things get extremely practical, okay? And we're going to look at what it means to be living sacrifices and the different categories that Paul addresses. So for this morning, though, I wanted to look at the issue of the deliverer, okay? We're here in Romans chapter 11, and let's pick it up here at verse 25, okay? Romans chapter 11, and begin here at verse 25. For I would not, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery, lest ye should be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part is happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in. And so all Israel shall be saved, as it is written, there shall come out of Zion the deliverer, and shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob. For this is my covenant unto them, when I shall take away their sins. As concerning the gospel, they are enemies for your sakes, but as touching the election, they are beloved for the Father's sakes. For the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. For as ye in times past have not believed God, yet have now obtained mercy through their unbelief, even so have these also now not believed, that through your mercy they also may obtain mercy. And please forgive me if I'm going to hack and cough, okay? I'm actually getting better. You should have seen me during the course of the week. So this is actually an improvement, all right? But I will apologize in advance if I start coughing, okay? We are looking at this section where Paul is demonstrating that Israel's future hope is an absolute certainty. Hence, you have, for example, there in verse 29, for the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. Ultimately, the resumption and the restoration of the nation of Israel and her prophetic program is something that is going to be very natural for God to do. Hence, you have this whole olive tree illustration. For God to regraft Israel back into the olive tree is something that is going to be quite natural. So Paul issues a very sobering warning, okay? The warning, of course, is in verse 25. Number one, don't be ignorant, okay? And what is it specifically that the believer is exhorted not to be ignorant about? Now, verse 25, brethren, I would not, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery. There is this mystery blindness that Paul is going to describe that the church should not be ignorant about. And we said some things already. Just real quickly, remember, today we are in this current dispensation of the grace of God. Israel nationally is experiencing this mystery type blindness, okay? So Paul concludes verse 25, lest you should be wise in your own conceits. There is an inherent danger to think and to believe that Israel now, because of her fallen status, because she has been cast away, we've said enough already about Israel being cast away. She's lost her place. She has lost her position of divine favor with Almighty God. The danger is to think that if God has cast Israel away, then God has replaced Israel with the church. Hence, it is commonly taught within the ranks of fundamentalism, for example, that we, the church, are spiritual Israel. That's what Paul's warning against. Don't be ignorant. And don't be wise in your own conceits. In fact, Paul earlier, he says, be not high-minded. It takes a high-minded, opinionated, conceited sense of superiority to think, if Israel failed, therefore we must be better. We as Gentiles, hence, are far more superior spiritually. That's what Paul is warning against.
For anyone to teach that we today are spiritual Israel in any way, shape, or form, that we are the benefactors of the covenant program, that we're the ones now that are going to receive all of the provisions and benefits of Israel's prophetic program, is to operate in the realm of conceited ignorance, okay? So, interesting, Paul begins this final section regarding Israel's future status by issuing a warning to who? The Gentiles, to the church, okay, at large. So, in light of, let's read the rest of verse 25, the middle of the verse, lest ye should be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part is happened to Israel until, so there's going to be a point in history where that mystery blindness is going to end, right? Well, until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in. The dispensation of the grace of God will come to an end. When this current dispensation of grace comes to an end, and it's called the fullness of the Gentiles, which has to do with the salvation of the Gentiles, not the times of the Gentiles. We talked about that last Sunday morning, okay? When the fullness, the purpose for which God is calling out from the Gentiles, those who respond positively to the message of grace, those who believe, he's creating a new man, he's creating this new creature, the church, which is his body, which, by the way, is destined to be the fullness of who? The fullness of a person. This is fascinating. Talk about identity. Yes, we have an identity. Our past begins at a cross. Our Christian lives begin in a graveyard. And it has everything to do with our identity in and through the Lord Jesus Christ. When he died, we learned that we died with him. When he was buried, we learned in Romans 6 that we were buried with him. When Jesus Christ rose from the dead, we learned in Romans chapter 6 that you and I were raised together with him in newness of life, okay? It all begins there at the cross. It begins in that graveyard, if you will. Just as our past has everything to do with our identity in the Lord Jesus Christ, we learn in the future. Now, Paul doesn't deal with this in the book of Romans. You go to the book of Ephesians, Paul develops that concept of fullness. And when Paul in the book of Ephesians develops the concept of fullness, I've been telling the Huntley Bible class, Ephesians is God's grace on steroids. The book of Romans, it highlights God's grace. And Paul says so much about grace. Ye are not under the law, but ye are what? Under grace, okay? When you go to the book of Ephesians, it isn't just grace. It's the riches. How can God's grace be any better? But see, that's the type of God we're privileged to call Father. Our Father, our Heavenly Father says, yeah, here's my grace in action through the shed blood of my Son. But there's a whole lot more going on. It's called the riches of his grace, the immense magnitude of what his grace is going to do for us. And it has to do with our identity, not just in the graveyard. It has to do with our identity in Christ. Where? In the realm of the heavenly places. We are the fullness of him that filleth all in all. That's the book of Ephesians. So when Paul uses that term fullness, there's a whole lot more packaged in there, okay? Just keep that in mind, because Paul's now going to talk about the fullness of Israel. So we know something about the fullness of the Gentiles. God, at some point in the future, from where we are at, he's going to conclude the dispensation of the grace of God. He's going to break off the branch, and he's going to regraft the natural branch, which is Israel, national Israel, okay? So the warning has been issued. Now verse 26, and all Israel shall be saved. Again, when the verse here talks about all Israel, it's not talking about all of apostate Israel. It's talking about the believing remnant in Israel. We're not going to go there. Remember Romans chapter 9? Not all Israel is what? Israel. Just because you're an Israelite ethnically does not mean by default you are a part of God's Israel, okay? So there is this believing remnant The Lord calls them the little flock. They're the true Israel. So when verse 26 talks about, so all Israel shall be saved, it's talking about the regenerated, born-again nation, those who are members of that identifiable group, the little flock, or that believing remnant, okay? We've said some things already about that. Keep reading. Verse 26, and so all Israel shall be saved. Now notice, as it is written, there shall come out of Zion the deliverer, and shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob, for this is my covenant unto them when I shall take away their sins. What Paul now is going to deal with, and this is I think, exciting. The Lord Jesus, in verse 26, is described as the deliverer, okay? Now, we need to understand something about Israel's program. Go back to verse 12 here, okay? Let's read verse 11. Go back to Romans 11, 11. I say then, have they stumbled? Who stumbled historically? Israel. That they should fall, God forbid. But rather through their fall, who fell historically? Israel. Salvation is come unto the Gentiles for to provoke them, Israel, to jealousy. Now look at verse 12. Now if the fall of them, by the way, has Israel fallen? See, this isn't, they have fallen. And verse 15 is very clear. For if the casting away of them, Israel's status and identity before God Almighty is, she's cast away. Is being cast away a good thing or a bad thing? You know, this morning, okay, I've been hacking for days. And I've been hacking, and I don't want to gross anybody out, but, you know, I'm hacking. And you know what I do with that tissue after I've hacked my lungs out, right? I cast it away, okay? Is there any value? I mean, yeah, I'm not grossing it. Listen, national Israel is of no value to God today. Now, I've just, threw a theological hand grenade in a lot of theological systems, right? Now, wait a minute. What did we read there in verse 28? How does God view Israel today in the dispensation of the grace of God? Look at verse 28. As concerning the gospel, they are friends. They are what? What is God's perspective of Israel right now in the Middle East? Now, am I an anti-Semite? Or did that verse just tell me they are what? Enemies. They're not friends. Now, when we get into Romans chapter 13, we're going to talk about human government, okay? And there's another touchy subject, right? Anyway, we're not going to talk about that this morning. All I'm saying is this. Israel's cast away. Israel is viewed in the sight of Almighty God as enemies. They're not friends. They're not sympathetic. I dare any of you right now to go to Jerusalem, set up a little stand, and start preaching Jesus Christ as the sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. I've got a map in front of my office, the persecuted church. You've heard of the voice of the martyrs, okay? Now, I don't care for some of their doctrinal, okay, I don't believe in a lot of their doctrinal stuff, okay, but they do a good job identifying areas around the globe where professed Christians are being persecuted, and they have three categories: those that are severely persecuted, let's say, you know, North Korea, Sudan, those that are friendly, countries that are friendly or neutral, and then there's a category where it's sort of an in-between, it's like a watch out. Christians aren't being persecuted outright, but they're also not friendly or neutral to Christians. There's a middle category, which is almost like they're on the watch list. You know what nation is on that watch list? The nation of Israel. You think you have the right to just preach Jesus Christ and the gospel of grace and the power of the cross without any retribution? I don't like pointing. So please, I'm not an anti-Semite, okay? In fact, I'm pro-Israel, the way Romans 11 is teaching being pro-Israel. God says, I'm going to deliver them. Listen, no nation today is going to be responsible for the establishment and for the blessing and all that kind of stuff. When we study prophecy, the point that Paul is making in verse 26 is that, listen, a deliverer is going to do this, okay? It's not going to take the United Nations or the League of Nations or any other political organization to do what God personally says, I'm going to send somebody. It's going to be my beloved son. And he's the one who's going to call out that nation. He's the one who's going to bring together and gather together the scattered remnant. He's the one who's going to deliver them during the course of that 70th week of Daniel. He's the one who's going to bring them into Zion. He's the one that's going to redeem and regenerate these people. He's the one who's going to set up that nation of priests. He's the one that's going to have a kingdom. See, Jesus Christ is going to do that. No political organization, state, nation is going to do anything that God says, I'm going to do it, okay? And so we need to be very careful when we start delving into the realm of politics, okay? We're not going to do what God says I'm going to do, okay? So anyway, now go back to verse 12. I know, here I am. Verse 12. Now, if the fall of them, and they have fallen, be the riches of the world, and the diminishing of them, the riches of the Gentiles. Notice what Paul says. How much more their what? Is Israel right now today enjoying their fullness? No. When is Israel going to enjoy their, quote, fullness? Verse 26. For out of Zion, what's going to happen? There shall come out of Zion a what? Now, this is, okay, we know something about our fullness. And our ultimate fullness, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. When Paul now talks about the fullness of Israel, which is not happening today, because Israel's fallen, she's cast away, she's actually an enemy of the gospel. She's not a friend of the gospel, okay? But Paul does say they're beloved for the Father's sake. Fathers, plural, not the fathers, that's Israel's fathers, okay? The fullness, there is a future time when Israel's going to enjoy her fullness, okay? And we're learning in verse 26 something about the Lord's role as Israel's deliverer. Now, this is what Paul is alluding to here, okay? In the Davidic covenant, and in fact, that's why he starts referring to the covenants. For example, 27, for this is my covenant unto them. Okay, look at verse 29. For the gifts and calling of God are with repentance. Have you ever heard of the sure mercies of David? Who did God promise the sure mercies of David? You and I as Gentiles, members of the body of Christ? Or what nation is anticipating the sure mercies of David? Listen, there are some covenants, there are some promises, there is a hope, there are some gifts, there are some calling that is restricted to one group of people, the nation of Israel. So Paul says, listen, if the fall of them be the riches of the world, which is a glorious thing, the world just doesn't appreciate how rich they really are. Rich in the sense that God has stayed the impending wrath. And he, in his goodness, is offering, by his act of reconciliation, he's offering salvation to the Gentiles. Listen, we're enjoying the riches, how much more their fullness? Now, the fullness of Israel, when does Israel fully enjoy their deliverance, their salvation? When do they fully enjoy the implementation and all that the covenants promise? When are they going to actually enjoy all of that? So that's what Paul now is beginning to describe. And he begins it in verse 26, and all Israel shall be saved. As there shall come out of Zion the deliverer. Now, the sure mercies of David in the book of Psalms. Tell you what, go to Psalms chapter. Let's go to Psalms 42. All right, Psalms chapter 42. The book of Psalms is going to provide detail regarding the Lord Jesus Christ's role as Israel's deliverer. Now, the book of Psalms. Some of you are familiar with this. Some of you have never heard of this, okay? The book of Psalms is divided into really how many books? Five. Now, some of you might have Bible editions. I had an old Bible that literally, like Psalms chapter 1, it would say book 1, okay? Psalms 42 would say book 2. Now, some of you might have a Bible edition. First of all, I hope you have a King James Version, okay? I'm not talking about translations. I'm talking about an edition. I had an edition that literally segregated the book of Psalms into the five identifiable books in the book of Psalms, okay? And some of you may have an edition that will tell you book one, book two, book three. Now, the question is this: why five books? And what are those five books doing? What are they communicating? What are they doing? But what does the word Psalms mean, by the way? A psalm, right? Now, later we're going to sing. I don't know if you call it a psalm. Technically, you know how the saints would sing? They would take truth. They would take God's word. Remember the song of Moses? Now, have you ever read Exodus? Is it Exodus 32? Forgive me if I don't remember. The song of Moses. And I remember I'm reading the song of Moses, and I'm thinking, I'm going to try to sing this. Have you ever tried singing the song of Moses? Nothing rhymes. I mean, when we sing, we try to have rhyme. You know, and I'm thinking, how did it sound? The song of Moses. Now, have you read the song of Moses? It's a chronology of the mighty God, God's deliverance of which people? Nation of Israel, out of the hard oppression of Egypt and so on and so forth. And you read the song of Moses, and it is an historic account, and it is exactly what it's God's word. The historic record and the historic testimony of what God did in giving birth to the nation of Israel. And, you know, it all begins with Abraham and so on. So you read all of these events, and then all of a sudden, you know, it talks about how the Egyptian chariots are destroyed and all of that. And I'm reading, I'm thinking, how in the world do you put this to music? And I tried singing it. Now, I'm not a musician to begin with, so I couldn't do it. But anyway, you know what a psalm is? Paul talks about psalms and spiritual songs and so forth. Listen, ultimately, it's taking God's word and putting it to music. Now, why would you take God's word and put it to music? In the beloved God. You know, there's a couple of reasons. Number one, when you sing the doctrine, it's a lot easier to retain, isn't it? What if you don't have God's word available? I mean, you ever live? We're fortunate. I mean, imagine being in a country where the Bibles are banned. There are countries right now where the Bibles are banned, right? You read about prisoners of war, whether it was Vietnam or wherever it was. And a lot of these prisoners, believers, there are prisoners, right? They didn't have access to Scripture. But you know what a lot of these prisoners were doing? They were recalling God's word. And you know, one of the easiest, best ways of memorizing something, you know what? You put God's word to song, and all of a sudden, it's available. The book of Psalms has to do with God's truth, God's word, which is put in a form of a song, music. For number one, the ease of memorization, but also don't forget, if God's word, written word, is unavailable for whatever reason, hey, it should reside where? Thy word, by the way, David in Psalms, thy word have I hid where? In my heart. I've taken God's word, I'm meditating upon it, and it's residing and dwelling in the realm of my inner man. So the issue of the Psalms, this is critically important. Now, I don't know if anybody could memorize the entire 150 chapters of the book of Psalms. But wait a minute. If you're with an entire people group, an entire nation, okay, you know, you can imagine it's possible to have the entire book memorized. The point is this. During the tribulational period, is it possible God's written word may not be easy access to it? You think that could be possible, right? So you read the book of Psalms, and wow, you know, you read about some of the hardship and the heartache and the oppression and the suffering and the persecution. Oh, yes, you read a lot about the deliverance and the joy and the future kingdom and so forth. But the book of Psalms has everything to do with what the little flock is going to experience during the 70th week of Daniel. Case in point, I ask you to go to Psalms 23. How many of you ever memorized? I remember as a kid, we had to memorize Psalms chapter 23. Remember Psalms chapter 23? The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want, right? He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. You know, he restoreth my soul. Look at verse 4, Psalms 23, verse 4. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. And, you know, what do? We devotionalize it, you know? Oh, yeah, I walk through the shadow of the valley of death. As though we really, any of you really walk through the valley of the shadow of death? You know, now, of course, what do we sometimes hear? You go to a funeral, and quite often, you know, you hear this passage being quoted. You know, Psalms 23 has nothing to do with your or my experience in life today. Don't get me wrong. Are there some things that we can learn? Absolutely. But verse 1, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. I mean, Jehovah Roi. There, you know, you have this Jehovah compound name. There's some things about Jehovah God and who he is to the nation of Israel. I am God. Jehovah, capital L-O-R-D, Lord, is going to be Israel's shepherd. So listen, when verse 4 talks about walking through the valley of the shadow of death, let's not devotionalize it and use it in reference to a loved one dying. It has everything to do with real people, God's people, that are going to literally walk through a valley of a shadow of death. It has everything to do with a future catastrophic event that we conveniently call the tribulational period, all right? So when you study the book of Psalms, it has everything to do with the way Israel is going to be able to handle the calamities of the 70th week of Daniel, okay? Please, I am not suggesting you should not read, learn, study, and appreciate what Psalms 23 is saying. But you have to keep it in its proper dispensational context. It's written to a future group of people who are literally going to... Verse 5, thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. I mean, this little flock, this believing remnant, they're literally going to have enemies seeking to exterminate them. Okay? And if you want the details, go to the book of Revelation. And you will learn about the details of walking through the valley of the shadow of death, preparing a table before mine enemies, and so on and so forth, okay? So, with that in mind, the book of Psalms, you take God's word, you put it to music, you store it in your heart, you're recounting it, you're recalling it, you're rehearsing it, you've got some doctrine that is going to equip that little flock, that remnant, to endure the calamities of the 70th week, and to continue to wait on the Lord and to have a real hope, a hope grounded in what God's word is teaching them, especially in the book of Psalms. So the five books in the book of Psalms, chapters 1 through 41, will provide details regarding Jehovah as Israel's redeemer. Okay? That would be book number 1. Now, for just to... The Deliverer, chapter 42 through 72, and that's the section that we're going to concentrate here on a little bit here. Chapters 42 through chapter 72 will focus on Jehovah God functioning as Israel's deliverer, okay? Then in chapters 73 through 89, you have details and doctrine describing Jehovah God as Israel's avenger, okay? Then in chapters 90 through 106, you have details regarding And I know people on the internet, you're not going to see this, but chapters 90 through 106 will provide details regarding Jehovah being Israel's king. And then the remaining fifth book, 107 through chapter 150, will describe Jehovah God functioning as Israel's blesser, okay? The five books that the book of Psalms is segmentized and categorized under regard the sure mercies of David. There are, and for lack of a better description, there really are these five mandates of the Davidic covenant. Okay? Hence, David wrote most of the Psalms. King David is the one who wrote most of the Psalms. He's the one, he's the figure through which God is now providing details regarding the sure mercies, the five mandates. Jehovah God is going to be Redeemer, Deliverer, Avenger, King, and Blesser, who ultimately is the Jehovah God of the Old Testament who became flesh in human history. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord Jesus Christ is the fulfillment. He will fulfill all five mandates of the Davidic covenant. Now, he already achieved something on the cross of Calvary as Redeemer. Okay? But what does Israel need in order to enjoy her fullness? She needs more than just a Redeemer. So what Paul strategically is doing is he is directing our attention to the next mandate of the Davidic covenant, the second book of the book of Psalms, chapters 42 through verse 72. Why does he say, out of Zion shall come a what? Deliverer. In light of Israel's future expectation that, hey, can you imagine her fullness? Wait till God fulfills those remaining mandates of the Davidic covenant. So let's talk a little bit this morning about that second mandate of the Davidic covenant, that second book in the book of Psalms. Now, all of the details, we're not obviously going to study 30 chapters, but chapters 42 through verse 72 has an emphasis on a deliverer. And now, just for sake of time, when Paul says, out of Zion shall come a deliverer, and we're going to see a couple of verses, for example, in Joel chapter 3, out of Zion, you know, Jesus Christ is going to roar out of Zion, okay? But the deliverance doesn't happen at the second coming. Don't get confused. Deliverance begins at the start of the 70th week, and it culminates at the second. This little arrow, I'm going to put a number 2 there. The literal return of Jesus Christ. Daniel chapter 2 describes that literal return of Jesus Christ as a stone cut, what? Without hands. And you know what that stone cut without hands is going to do? Destroy all the empires and kingdoms of the world. Does that include the United States of America? Yes. So now I'm not only an anti-Semite, I'm an American. And that cannot be further than the truth. And I'm going to say it when we get to Romans chapter 13. I love America. America is a kingdom of the world. I think it's the best kingdom of the world. But my citizenship, I'm a member of the kingdom of heaven. I'm a member of the kingdom of God's dear son. You know, Paul keeps talking about the kingdom. The kingdom of God is not meat and drink. Remember what? Why does Paul keep telling us the kingdom of God is not this, meat and drink, but the kingdom of God is love, peace, righteousness? Please, America, Jesus Christ is not America's king. Okay? If you're a believer, you're a member of the kingdom of Jesus Christ. And our kingdom is not based upon meat, drink, and physical. No, the kingdom that we, our conversation is where? In heaven. Our political identity is where? In heaven. So when that stone cut without hands comes crashing down and it obliterates all of the human empires and governmental institutions and kingdoms that were ever erected, is America spared? No, it's not spared. Yeah, I can't wait till we talk about some of that, Romans. We're going to talk about, real hot-button issue, right? Was America founded as a Christian nation? We're going to talk about that one. But I know some people say, no, America was founded as a Christian nation, okay? We'll address some of that stuff. By the way, whether it is or whether it's not, all I know is this: America is a kingdom of the world, best one there is. But there's another kingdom, and that's the kingdom we're concerned with and preoccupied with, okay? So when this stone, now, the deliverance will begin, when the issue of delivering actually begins at the start here, okay? And then guess what's going to happen 7 years later? A deliverer, that deliverer now is going to appear. Listen, the deliverer's already begun doing some delivering. But what Paul is describing is, and then there's a point in time, the deliverer who's delivering and he's carrying out and he's fulfilling and he's implementing the mandate of that second Davidic covenant, I will deliver you people. Well, eventually, after the 70th week, it comes to an end. Guess what that deliverer is going to do? Now it all culminates, and the deliverer now, in a tremendous manifestation of who he is, he's going to come roaring out of Zion, okay? So just remember, the deliverance doesn't begin at his return. Deliverance is already occurring, and now the deliverer is going to manifest himself, okay? So just keep that in mind as we look at some of these passages regarding Israel's deliverance that Paul is drawing our attention to, because, listen, the first mandate has been achieved by virtue of the cross, the Redeemer. That number one is done, but there's still four that have not occurred. Paul's talking about what? Her fullness. It's not full yet, okay? It ain't going to happen yet, until the Lord starts implementing some of this stuff out there. Go to Psalms 50, all right? Forget 42. If you read Psalms 42 through 72, you'll grasp, you'll begin to comprehend, wow, there's some real promises of provision. There's some promises of deliverance that God is extending to the believing remnant during the 70th week of Daniel, okay? And we're not going to cover how some of that stuff. I'll just say this. Was there ever a time when Jehovah God supernaturally made provision for his people? Remember what the mighty God of Israel did back here after he delivered Israel out of Egypt, right? And remember, they didn't have water. They didn't have food. They didn't have this. 10 times. God performs miracle. He leads them in the wilderness. He's providing. And they're whining and they're complaining and they're murmuring. And they said, we wish we were slaves again. By the way, Israel, after they saw the strong armor of the Lord, you know what they missed? They missed the flesh pots of it. They enjoyed their past identity and their past life as slaves. And before we say, what a bunch of dodos and idiots. Were we slaves to sin, according to Romans 6? Don't we sometimes gravitate to that past identity? I miss the flesh pots of my past. So we better be careful, be not high-minded. Just because Israel's... Listen, we sometimes miss being slaves. What kind of a slave? Slaves to sin, okay? When God says, you're free to be servants of who? Almighty God, okay? So be careful. But here we have Israel whining, complaining, and murmuring, and so forth, and accusing God of leading us out here just to cut us down, just to kill us. Bunch of bizarre stuff. Well, let me just say this. All that God supernaturally did in delivering Israel is going to be repeated during the most horrendous persecution that Israel will ever experience at the hands of the Antichrist and that 10-nation confederacy that is out there implementing a plan of genocide. Okay? Now, you read Revelation, and there's some things that are going to be happening out in the wilderness, and there's going to be supernatural. Listen, that's part of the deliverance. Psalms chapter 50. Psalms chapter 50. Let's begin here at verse 1. The mighty God. The mighty God. You know, we almost should compare this with Isaiah chapter 9. We won't. Isaiah chapter 9. Wonderful Counselor. Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. You know how many titles are listed in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6? Guess how many titles? How many? Five. And those five titles of Almighty God correspond and correlate with the sure mercies of David, the five mandates of the Davidic covenant. Only one of them so far. Her fullness is when the remaining four are ultimately implemented. Okay? So here we go, verse 1. The mighty God, even the, notice, capital L, capital O, capital O-R, capital D, the Lord, that's Jehovah. The mighty God, even the Lord hath spoken and called the earth from the rising of the sun unto the going down thereof. Out of where? Zion, the perfection of beauty, God hath shined. Now, this is what the remnant is going to say. Have we seen anything shining out of Zion? And we're not even studying Zion. Zion is an area in Israel, okay? Just a little southeast of Jerusalem. But anyway, do we see anything shining out of Zion? No. This is the cry of the believing remnant. By the way, this is a song that they're going to put to memory as they're going through the tremendous suffering and persecution. You know what they're going to hang their hat on? You know, Hebrews talks about the hope, which is like an anchor. You know what they're hoping for? Listen, one day, Zion is going to shine. And keep that in mind. Out of Zion, there's going to what? Come forth a deliverer. Verse 2, out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God hath shined. Our God shall come and shall not keep silence. A fire shall devour before him. Remember that. When we go to Joel, guess what? He's going to come roaring out of Zion. And you know what's preceding him? A fire. This is all yet future. A fire shall devour before him. It shall be a very tempestuous. It'll be very tempestuous round about him. Keep your finger here. Go to Joel chapter 3. Let's go to Joel chapter 3. Go to Joel chapter 3. We're going to start flying a little bit here, okay? Because we really got to get moving. Joel chapter 3, and look there at verse 14. Joel chapter 3, verse 14, okay? Joel chapter 3, verse 14. Multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision. Oh, what book's going to provide details about this valley? What? You heard of Megiddo? You heard of Armageddon? What book gives you details about what's happening there in Armageddon? Megiddo, book of Revelation, okay? Multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision, for the day of the Lord is near. In the valley of decision, the sun and the moon shall be darkened, and the stars shall withdraw their shining. The Lord also shall roar out of Zion and utter his voice from Jerusalem, and the heavens and the earth shall shake, but the Lord will be the hope of his people and the strength of the children of Israel. So shall you know that I am the Lord your God, dwelling in Zion, my holy mountain. Listen, God promises that he personally is going to be Israel's deliverer. The deliverance which is being experienced is going to culminate where one day he's going to set down and he's going to come out of Zion. And there's going to be a flame of avengement, by the way, the fire and so forth. But Zion, Zion, go back to Psalms chapter 50, Psalms chapter 50. Verse 4, Psalms chapter 50, verse 4. He shall call to the heavens from above and to the earth that he may judge his people. Gather my saints together unto me. Huh. My saints. You know who the saints are? Drop down to verse 7. Hear, O my people. So the saints, these are whose people? These are God's people, in contradistinction to who? You have my people, but guess what? At the same time, look at verse 7. Hear, O my people, and I will speak. God's going to talk to who? My people. The saints. They're called the saints. We don't, for sake of time, if you want to go to Matthew 24, verse 31. All right, keep your finger. Go to Matthew 24, verse 31. Go to Matthew 24, verse 31. Matthew 24, verse 31. The saints that are going to hear something, okay? Matthew chapter 24, verse 31. And he shall send his angels with the great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. This is God's elect. These are God's people. Go back to Psalms chapter 50. And who are the other group? Who is the other group? Look at verse 7 again, Psalms 50, verse 7. Hear, O my people, and I will speak. But notice, O Israel, and I will testify against thee. He's got good news for the saints, but he's going to testify against who? Now, who? What's wrong with Israel? Drop down to verse 16. But unto the wicked, God saith, what hast thou to do to declare my statutes, or that thou shouldst take my covenant in thy mouth? What group of people would actually cling to the Old Testament program? You notice the thing about the statutes? What right does Israel have in clinging to the law? Now, before you think, well, wait a minute, this is really confusing. Didn't God give Israel the law? Yes. Did God give to Israel the statutes? Yes. Did he give to them a sacrificial system? Yes. But what did Israel at large do? Well, in unbelief, they rejected it. You know what's going to happen during that 70th week? That old-time religion is reinstituted, hence the fig tree. That old covenant program is reinstituted. And guess who's going to give his blessing? The Antichrist is going to give his blessing. So you're going to have the wicked nation of Israel, the apostate nation of Israel, they're operating under the old covenant system of statutes and laws and touch and taste and blood animal sacrifices and so on and so forth. But you know what God's people, the remnant, will be doing? They're not going to be involved in all that. In fact, look there at verse 5. Look there at verse 5, chapter 50, verse 5. Gather my saints together unto me, those that have made a covenant with me by sacrifice. What kind of sacrifice? So now it's getting, what sacrifice are God's people offering? Go to verse 13. Verse 13. Will I eat the flesh of bulls or drink the blood of goats? Offer unto God thanksgiving and pay thy vows unto the Most High and call upon me in the day of trouble. I will what? Deliver thee, and thou shalt glorify me. Will members of that little flock, the believing remnant, the true elect, the saints of Almighty God, are they involved in the old covenant system of animal sacrifices and statutes and ordinances and so forth? No. Who is involved in that old-time religion during the 70th week? Apostate Israel. That's why God says, I'm going to testify against you. So now, the sacrifice that the saint, the true believing remnant, they're not participating in apostasy. It used to belong to God, but it's now been apostatized by the Antichrist. Go to verse 23. Drop down to verse 23. Whoso offereth praise glorifies me. And to him that ordereth his conversation aright will I show the salvation of God. Drop down to chapter 51 and notice verse 15. Chapter 51, verse 15. 51:15. O Lord, open thou my lips, and my mouth shall show forth thy praises. For thou desirest not sacrifice, else would I give it. So wait a minute. The little flock, they know enough not to go into that temple that's going to be rebuilt at the start of the 70th week of Daniel. Remember what the Lord Jesus says, listen, in that middle of the week when the abomination of desolation rises up, what are you supposed to be doing? You better get out of town here. Why will the little flock not participate in the resumption of the old-time religion? It's been corrupt and polluted and apostatized. You know why they're offering animal sacrifices and shedding the blood of animals? Because they've rejected the claims of the one who shed his own blood. So the only sacrifice that is legitimate during that tribulational period is the sacrifice, verse 16, for thou desirest not sacrifice, else would I give it. Thou delighteth not in burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit and a broken and contrite heart. O God, thou wilt not despise. Go to Hebrews chapter 13. Hebrews chapter 13. This is, now you see why Israel better memorize this information? So you imagine, now I don't know what's going to happen at the end of the dispensation of grace. Who knows? In the Middle East, especially in the land of Israel, the New Testament might be banned, outlawed. I don't know what's going to happen, okay? But all I know is this, that Israel, the true believing remnant, they better start hiding some doctrine in their hearts. In Hebrews chapter 13, look there in Hebrews chapter 13. And notice there verse 15, Hebrews 13, verse 15. Hebrews 13, verse 15. By him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually, that is, the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. Well, verse 16, but to do good and to communicate, forget not, for such sacrifices God is well pleased. So there is a contrast here. The renewed, reinstituted system of worship that comes right out of the Old Testament. But you have the believing remnant, the elect, God's saints, that understand God doesn't want that. Doesn't Hebrews teach that the blood of bulls and goats, how many sins were atoned for by the blood of bulls and goats? None. Because the Redeemer already shed his blood for that remnant. So what is the remnant doing? They're praising God. They're giving God thanks, not like Israel did in the past. Listen, did they give God thanks when the quail and the manna fell down? No. But will the little flock give thanks when mom can't even buy milk for the baby and you can't go to the ATM? You can't, you know, you're in hiding. You're fleeing for your life. And you have the military operation out there in the Middle East that is targeting this little flock. You know, Revelation provides all of those details. All right, go back to Psalms chapter 50. So now we'll get to this deliverance issue. Listen, who do you turn to if you're a member of little flock? Where do you go? Psalms chapter 50. Psalms chapter 50 and verse 15 again. Psalms chapter 50 and verse 15. And call upon me in the day of trouble. You know, that adds new meaning. When the Lord Jesus Christ taught the little flock during his messianic ministry, ask and ye shall what? Knock and ye shall find. That isn't directed to a Christian today in the dispensation of grace. Now, I know there's a movie coming out called War Room. What's the subtitle? Power Prayer. I forgot what it is. And I don't plan to watch the movie myself. But anyway, I got a feeling, I suspect what they're going to do. they believe in the power of prayer, right? Just pray, and the power of prayer is going to. And you know, they recite, and they appeal to ask, and ye shall what? Receive. The Lord Jesus Christ is talking about this group of people that are going through sufferings that will be unimaginable. They're the ones that God promises supernatural provision. Verse 15, call upon me in the day of trouble. Not because you got a flat tire or you got cancer. Now, did I just say don't pray? Oh, please. But we got to understand, prayer in the future is different than the things we learned about regarding prayer in Romans chapter 8, for example, okay? Paul in Romans 8, what does he say? We don't know how to pray for as we ought. Wait a minute. Jesus said, ask and you shall receive. In fact, you know what the Lord Jesus said in Matthew 7? He said, all things that ye ask for, go ahead. And, you know, some people claim, well, okay, the great genie in the sky, you know, I need this, that, and the other thing, you know, power of prayer and all that kind of stuff, you know? And then Paul the Apostle says, but we don't know how to pray for as we ought. Does that sound like a man with confidence when it comes to his prayer life? Why didn't he say, hey, just remember what Jesus said, ask and you're going to receive. Paul says, I don't know how to pray for as I ought to pray. That tells us something. There's a way in which we're supposed to pray. Okay? So, anyway, verse 15, I'm going to deliver thee. The promise is, I will deliver thee, and thou shalt glorify me. Okay? Verse 18. Oh, wait, that's not it. Oh, no, chapter 51. Go to chapter 51. Psalms chapter 51. Chapter 51, verse 14. Chapter 51, verse 14. Deliver me. Verse 18. Do good in thy good pleasure unto who? Unto where, rather? Unto Zion. Oh, so now you begin to go to chapter 52. Chapter 52. And this, to me, is just phenomenal. Chapter 52, look there at verse 8. But I am like a green olive tree. Where did we read about green olive trees? In Romans chapter what? Now, we're going to stop, of course. This is fascinating. The whole doctrine of Israel's deliverer, which is the next mandate, which ultimately has to do with the fullness. When they're suffering out there, Christ is giving to Israel that believing remnant, that the true Israel of God, the saints. Listen, I am going to come, and I'm going to roar out of Zion. And what he and the believer's mentality, this is amazing, verse 8, but I am like a green olive tree. The little flock, they understand they've been regrafted. They've been verse 8, but I am like a green olive tree in the house of God. I trust in the mercy of God forever and ever. Keep your finger there. Go back to Romans chapter 11. Romans chapter 11. The little flock, they understand what's happening dispensationally. You know why it's important to know where they are dispensationally? Because there are some supernatural things that they now can anticipate. We can't anticipate some of that stuff. But in Romans chapter 11, they understand we're like a green olive tree. Now, remember what Paul wrote here in Romans chapter 11 and verse 24. Romans 11, verse 24. For if thou wert cut out of the olive tree, which is wild by nature, and were grafted contrary to nature onto a good olive tree, notice, how much more shall these, which be the natural branches, be grafted into their own, what? Olive tree. They got it. They understand. You know what these guys? They know Romans. That's just my suspicion. We're like a green olive tree. We're back in the prophetic program. They now know how to respond. They know how God's working now. Let's close Psalms chapter 53, all right? We're going to have to stop. Psalms chapter 53. There's so much more. Again, that section, casually read chapters 42 to 72, and you talk about deliverance, especially out of Zion, chapter 53, Psalms 53, and look there at verse verse 6. Look at verse 6. Oh, that the salvation of Israel were come out of where? Zion, when God bringeth back the captivity of his people, Jacob shall rejoice, and Israel shall be glad. That's what Paul's talking about. Father, we do thank you for your grace, your love, your goodness. We thank you, Father, for certainly our hope and who we are in Christ today as members of living members of his living body. But Lord, we certainly want to just rejoice in your wisdom, the gifts and calling, the promises that you've secured and that you will fulfill with your people, especially those who truly respond by faith. And believe what it is you're doing in the future. Again, may we never confuse ourselves with Israel's identity. May we keep those two programs as distinct and as separate as you have in your word. And yet, may we just learn and may we rejoice in what it is you will accomplish in the future. We again thank you for all of this in Christ Jesus' name. Amen.